Everybody, this is Apostle Joshua, and I give leadership to Faith Empowerment Christian Center. And I'm so excited about what God is doing in this particular season, especially in the month of September. The Bible talks about the month of September as a spiritual month, and that Rosh Hashanah. The Bible says in the book of Ezekiel that God told them that the beginning of a new year, which is the 10th month, which means spiritually, the month of September begins to be the new year in what God regards as a new year that you're entering. So as Christians, they have an advantage that as others are celebrating a new year in the month of January, Christians are already in a new year in the month of September. So we organized a prophetic conference, which we called Prayer Revival, because you cannot step into a new atmosphere or a new season when you do not understand the power of prayer. So I had to look for somebody who understands the mystery and the principles and the strategies of prayer, because not everybody knows how to pray. And those who know how to pray, they know because they have been taught how to pray. So I went all the way to Pretoria, Hatfield, IM Church, and I picked a man that I connected in the spirit, a man that has been chosen by God, a man anointed, Pastor David D. He is the co-founder of IM Church, and we are blessed. We did one service already, and we're expecting God to do more. Man of God.
Amen. How are you doing? What a great welcoming. Thank you so much. So good to be here. We've been praying about this service. It's just an honor to be here. I'm so excited to be speaking on this platform.
Praise God. Praise God. So it's interesting because Pastor David, but you are an artist also.
Yes.
let's talk about the journey of music.
All right. So a journey of music, when I was young, 10 years old, I had a desire of being a singer. But my desire was not just to sing, be famous, was to write songs and was to influence the music industry in a gospel, you know, industry in South Africa. So then I had a privilege to start my solo career in 2006. Then I became an artist. We did concerts, we did different shows, we traveled around, recorded my first live album in 2010. And then, so I remember we had motorbikes, you know, on a video, great, thousands of people showed up. And it was the first album. We recorded a second one in 2013. We featured great artists at that time, and we had a third one in 2017. We did it on a rooftop in Johannesburg. Wow. So if you see the video, we are right on top of Johannesburg. You can actually see the whole city there. And then the last one we did in 2019, it was awesome. We did in a place called Delmas. It's just in Mpumalanga, next to Gauteng. So that's been my journey. I've worked with different artists, different producers. I have featured many people. So the last art song I have is with Khayyam Tetwa, who is one of the great artists in South Africa. And then, yeah, the journey's been sweet. So I am a recording artist.
Wow. Speaking about that song, I was listening to it. It's Keleza Moya.
Yes.
And it's interesting. The question becomes, what inspired you to write that song? And what is the meaning of Keleza Moya?
Yeah, it's a good question. So Keleza, it means flow in Zulu. Mm. The water or the river is flowing. So the way the waters are moving. So that's what Keleza means. So Keleza Moya is Holy Spirit flow. So the song came at church. I love those songs that comes during the prayer time. And then suddenly as the team was playing, I could hear the sound, you know, Umoya wako siyawudinga, Holy Spirit, we need you now. Then the song kept on coming, and then it went further. Then it just said, Holy Spirit, come into my heart, fill me, I need you now. And the song Keleza came about. So when we were singing that song at church, then I thought, if we are recording it, who is best to amplify it? Because sometimes artists, they have a better platform, have a different platform. Then I thought Khaya Tetwa is a great vocalist and is a great producer, because also he writes songs. Then I sent him a song. I said, what do you think? He says, I love it. Let's record it. Then we did it. And then it was just a powerful experience. And the song is still growing. People are still getting to hear about it. And it's ministering to many people. To us, it's a prayer song.
It is a powerful song. I was listening to it when I was driving, and you can feel the anointing.
Amen.
And you can feel the atmosphere changing. It doesn't matter where you are, you're in the car, it just automatically shifts. So as an artist, you're an artist. You are a family man.
Yes.
You are also a pastor, a man of God.
Yes.
How do you balance the three?
Oh, it's a great question. I think just understand these are different things. Mm. At church, I'm the pastor, I'm a shepherd, I lead people. So I need to be a pastor and focus on that. So at home, I'm a father, I'm a husband. I need to close the box in the things of church and be available. Which means if my son has to be in a sport at school, I can't say, but I'm praying.
Yeah.
I need to show up as a father. Mm. And then and also as an artist, it's work for me. So I go to work, like anybody goes to work. So the interesting thing about the music industry and the church, the industry is about sales, it's brand. So everything it's like fake. Yeah. You must look like you are there,
yeah.
But that's the industry, music industry. While church is about souls. So industry, sales, this one, souls. Now souls, they don't want fake. They want, if you talk prayer, you must pray.
You must pray.
If you talk giving, you must give. While the other side, you can hire aeroplanes, you can hire, because the music videos, some of the houses we have and cars you see, it's hired, you know, the cameras we have, because it just must look like. But here, you must be real. So to balance that, it took time for me. The anointing requires you to be broken.
Mm-hmm.
While in the industry, fame needs you to be put together. So you sort of hold yourself, you appear, you must dress a certain way, you must speak a certain way. But in a ministry, you need to be broken.
Mm-hmm.
So when the Holy Spirit moves and the tears are flowing, you can't be worrying about makeup.
Wow.
But when you do music videos, you can't be crying because you're ruining your makeup.
So you say in the music, you have to be put in, but in the ministry, you have to be broken.
You have to be broken.
You can explain a little bit about that.
That's, I think, you know, when we say brand, a brand is something that somebody tells you. No, don't look, you know, lose weight. No, dress like this. No, you are this. So you are put together, you are made into an image that people can either worship or praise or consume, but they must see you. So you create that, so you are put together either by yourself, but you must believe that you are a brand.
Mm-hmm.
That's why some people, they can be at church, but because they're a brand, when you say, oh, come and sing, they say, oh, you didn't book me. You didn't invite me. You need to talk to my manager because somebody is leading me. Somebody has put me together. So, but in a ministry, you must be broken. And God allows you to be broken in many ways that can happen. There's no pattern. One of the ways to be broken is to be forgotten. You know, when Moses had to leave Egypt, he was a guy who was put together, this leader, this person who was famous, because I mean, one of the sons of Pharaoh, so he was very much put together. But now, in a desert, no one knows you. So when you try to say, I am Moses, say, Moses from where?
From where?
You know, what is famous about you? But it took 40 years of being not known behind the mountain. And then that's where God finally speaks to him. Because God can't speak to you while you're this image that you have made for yourself.
Wow, wow. That's powerful. And I know you are a man of God, so you understand a little bit. In the area of, you told me you were in the praise and worship.
Yes.
Then you went to choir.
Yes.
Then you became a praise and worship leader.
Yeah.
And then you became an artist.
Yeah.
If I'm to pick, let's say, four.
Yeah.
Challenges that you have seen everywhere you do workshops,
yes,
in different places,
yes,
in different churches. Which are the four major challenges that you have experienced that in every church, the worship team, the ushering team, the leadership, you have to deal with? If four, which one would you pick?
That's a very big question because there are many areas.
I want four major ones.
So I think number one is recruiting. A choir needs fresh faces, fresh voices, new energy. Ushers need new people who won't just say, we're wearing black and white, just like we did last week. You need somebody to say, what about this color? What about we stand like this? What about we do this? Every ministry needs new people. So I think the first challenge we're facing is that we have visitors, but we're not carrying them into ministries. So the church is packed, but we are not able to get them joining ministries and encouraging, you know, the ministry. So that's problem number one. Problem number two is building families. Within the choir, there must be a sense of I belong. These are my friends. These are people, when it's my birthday, I'd rather be with them. When I don't have money and I'm facing a challenge, the first people I call is my ministry people. So I think that's the second thing that needs to be built. We need to focus on build family, build friendship. Now, there's two ways of building. There's a natural building and there's a spiritual building. Natural, we call them team buildings. We normally go for a picnic, go for movies, go for a bowling, do a braai. Those are natural, playing games. Spiritual building, you have to fast together. You have to pray together. You have to have like Bible classes together. So that's spiritual building. Most of us, we build natural. So there's a lot of parties. But now our relationship is a plastic. It's not deep. So it's weak, you know. It's not rooted. But if we want to build properly, we then need to sort of fast together, pray together. Yeah. So what happens then? People grow in a choir. So when they face storm, they won't just fall off because of the deep relationship we have with God and with one another, like corporate prayer. Okay, so I think for me, that is building family. That's very important. Number three is growth. Are we growing? So there's growth in numbers, there's growth spiritually. So that's what most ministries are challenged with. Are we growing in performance? Because remember, you can't be singing the same song you're singing 2 years ago. Yeah. You want the pastor to preach a new message, but you want to sing your Alpha and Omega. And then you're expecting a fresh anointing. No, fresh anointing goes with a fresh prophetic song. Mm-hmm. There must be a new sound. With me, well, as a musician, I easily get bored if it's a repetitive. So the next Sunday, I want something different. Mm-hmm. I wanna be spontaneous and let the Holy Spirit hear my heart in a new way. So I think growth is important. Are the people growing? Are the ashes growing? Mm-hmm. You know, that is very important. I think just the last one, one of the challenges that we see at church is probably people don't know the end goal. When you start as a Christian, where are you ending? Because if you go to school, it's grade one, you know there's grade 12. Mm-hmm. If you go to university, you know that there's graduation. Yeah. But at church, where is the end point? Mm-hmm. So I think the challenge is that we don't know the end point. The end point is simple. Paul says, by now you ought to be a teacher. You are still a praise and worship leader. 10 years later, you are still singing songs, mm-hmm. and you don't want to let people come in. So which means you start in a serving, maybe in a choir, but you must grow to be in a teaching level. Mm-hmm. Either you teach a home cell, either you become a junior pastor, either you join the evangelic team. You can still be singing, but there is progressive growth. Mm-hmm. So I think these are four things that we need to focus on in ministries.
Wow, that's powerful, because there's a point that you touched that says you spoke about spiritual growth.
Yeah.
Then there is team
building. Natural, yeah.
Natural growth.
Yeah.
The spiritual you talked about, you should pray together.
Yeah.
It's interesting because we are having a conference about prayer.
Yeah.
Prayer revival.
Yeah.
And yesterday we had a powerful service. You
Amen.
Taught about prayer. You taught about prayer is worship. Prayer is a surrendering.
Yeah.
Prayer Requesting. Is a request. Prayer is thanking God.
Yeah.
You touched many things about that. I want you have a book.
Yes.
About prayer.
Power of prayer.
Now, you spoke about, you used to be a 3-minute prayer person. you used to pray 3 minutes and
yes.
You didn't see the reason why you should pray longer.
Yeah.
You didn't even spend time in prayer. Now you have the ability to pray longer.
So I can pray as long as I want.
You can pray as long as you want.
Yeah.
Now, how did you get to that level?
Okay.
Because I've
great
seen
question.
People don't know what to say in prayer. They
yes.
run out of things.
Yes. They
get bored. Especially me, as a man of God, you get that. You say, let's pray. 2 minutes now, you're already speaking in tongues because you don't know what to to spell.
Yeah.
How does one grow from a 3-minute prayer to a 1-hour prayer, 2 hours prayer, 3 hours prayer? How did you get to that extent?
Sure. Yeah. It's also, it's a big question. Mm. I'll just try to summarize it. I listened to a teaching. I was in a conference. I listened to a teaching. So I was already starting to ask God. I'm leading a church now. I need to know how to pray. My wife could pray. She could do all-night prayers. Mm-hmm. Me, it's Father, God bless this food. That is as far as I can go. And then I find myself singing when it's prayer time. I find myself reading the Bible when it's prayer time. So I was concerned about my prayer capacity. Mm-hmm. Then I was in this conference, and then Pastor Bert Pretorius is leading a Triple C church in Pretoria. Mm-hmm. And he was just talking about a very simple message about the disciples, they asked Jesus. Mm-hmm. So if disciples ask Jesus, who are we not to ask?
Wow.
You say, ask the Lord to teach you how to pray. And God says, our Father who art in heaven, now, you know. And then when he made that prayer, he said, but Jesus didn't mean we should repeat that all the time.
Yeah.
But that's a model. So you can say, worship, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. That's worship. Mm-hmm. But now worship, that word alone is reverence. It's big. You can just thank God for who he is. Mm-hmm. You can spend an hour just worshiping.
True.
You can pick a song. You can just, you know, then he says, let your will be done on earth as it is. That's surrender. Mm-hmm. So how many things we need to surrender? From family to business to some of our cousins. There's so many things to surrender. Yeah. Then the third one is a request. Give us this day our daily bread. So when he was teaching, then suddenly the whole thing, my eyes were open. Then the book came up out of that Lord's Prayer. Mm-hmm. So then I started practicing. Okay, said, okay, how am I going to do it? Then since I love music, so I choose songs. On my phone, I've got what you call a prayer song list. Mm-hmm. So my prayer song list can be 2 hours.
Wow.
So I won't stop praying until I'm done with the 2 hours. Because the music is playing, worship music is playing. So I'll say, okay, I'll take the first prayer point with the song. So when the song ends, then I switch to a second prayer point. So if I've got 5 prayer points and I've got a 10-minute song, so 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. So 15 minutes, it's done, me just praying. And I said, let me just pray in my language, in understanding. I will pray in tongues. We will get to that. But let me just let my mind and my body enjoy to speak to God and then have words to say to God. So this model, I call it a petition prayer. That's how I started. I just used that. And then, of course, we went further by searching scriptures where I understood there's intercession. That's okay, let me try this intercession, how it works. Now, with intercession, when I started praying, we are like 8 of us at home. So I said, okay, I'll start with my brother and sisters. I promise you, in 30 minutes, I only covered 3 people. And I realized that, you know, because when you pray for one person, and then you are praying, and you are praying in the spirit, God starts giving a lot of things. Then I realized intercession, it has to be scheduled, or else you'll only be praying for 5 people. If you're leading a church of 100 people, out of 100 people, probably you have, what, 20 leaders? How many times are you praying for your leaders? So then I took this, on Monday, I'll pray for 3 leaders and 3 of my family members. Tuesday, I'll pray for other 3 because I want to spend time, give them a good enough time to stand in a gap, seek the Lord. When the Lord says something, either I write it down or I just pray about it. So intercession was introduced, you know. Then another prayer was introduced, was the devotion prayer, just to pray in tongues, sing songs, and just whatever the Holy Spirit wants to say. Then I realized that, oh, an hour is not enough.
It's not enough.
Yeah, it's not enough. So that's how I started. Practically, our Father who art in heaven was a start. Intercession, like if you say, maybe you are going for a business meeting and you tell me, say, man of God, stand with me. So I add that on my intercession list. So when I'm praying on Monday, then let's say I'm praying for 5 people, because I can't pray for more, because each can take you, you see, as long as you sense the burden, because you need to stop or move on when there's peace. Like, okay, everything's fine. So if you are number 3, then I'm stuck on you. So I'm going to have to just keep praying and praying, praying in the spirit, what the Lord is saying, standing in a gap. So that is intercession. So when I did these prayers, then I realized that this thing must be a daily thing, because you can't cover everything. So the 2-minute prayer, I needed to be renew my mind altogether.
That's important. Then you said tongues.
Yes.
So you're talking about praying in your understanding.
Yes.
You're praying for your mother, you're praying for your brothers,
yes,
you're praying for your sisters. It's praying in your understanding.
Understanding, yes.
What significance is it to add tongues in prayer?
Okay. That's a very powerful question. So praying in understanding, which means you are aware of what you're doing. You have to pray in understanding, but you are limited to what you know. So when you pray in the spirit or praying in tongues, the Holy Spirit now gives you other things you did not plan or you did not understand. Like, you know, Paul says, I pray more in tongues. So which means he spends a lot of time praying. But when he starts praying in tongues, he's withdrawing and he's pulling things that he did not even plan. So there's many other prayers that probably even tonight we'll talk about when it comes to an intercession prayer. Intercession adds to what I call a prophetic prayer, and then it adds into what I call a war prayer. That's my favorite one. A war prayer is an intercession prayer. So what happens, let's say, for instance, somebody were buying something and then the seller was making a backdoor deal and cheating us. Then I went to God, I look for the verse of when people cheat you, what is the Lord saying? Then I use the voice, I use the word of God. I said, according to 1, 2, 3, the Bible said, and this is my rightful thing. So whatever they are doing, it's going to fall flat now in Jesus' name. Then I pray in a spirit and the Lord gives me utterance, which means he gives me words to say, this cannot happen. The word says this will not happen. So I refuse this. And then I say, justice will take place. You know, so that's intercession, but it's war because I'm fighting, but in a closet. So then the next day, a person called and said, no, I changed my mind. You get what is right. The deal is okay. So that's intercession. So intercession is not just praying for somebody, but it's to stand for even issues that are coming against you, are coming against your family, are coming against church. So intercession, you pray in understanding because it's called when God gives you utterance or when God gives you declaration. You have to speak so that you believe it. You can't believe tongues because you don't understand. So tongues are mysteries. You are praying things that you don't understand. But the reason you have to pray in tongues is so that you have new words, not the words you had. Because the words you had is God bless his food. You just pray for a petrol. But if you pray in tongues, you realize somebody's about to be in an accident. Then you switch from praying for petrol and food, then you start praying the real stuff that the Holy Spirit sees. So it's more like tapping into supernatural and praying what is happening currently. So it's a more of updated prayer. So praying in tongues is to hear what the Lord is saying. Praying in understanding is just to speak in what is in your heart. But what is in our heart is limited to what we know.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. So there are some people, many people that are watching this video that they struggle to pray longer.
They
tend to quote scriptures like, God knows what you want before you even ask. So sometimes I just have to cry and God already knows what I want.
Yeah.
Right? And then you come and you get a revelation about how to pray longer in prayer. I can feel the punch and the change that brings. Now, what advantage does someone who can pray long, understanding all the strategies, the pattern of prayer, and can pray longer, what advantage do they have to someone who can only come and pray for 3 minutes?
Yeah. No, it's also a great question. The person who can pray longer, they have more revelation. So it's more like, how can I put it? A person who has more access to finances do more. A person who has little money, they can cry all they like, but you don't have money. So prayer gives you access and depth. So if you are prophesying, you see, like, make an example, let's say talking with prophets. Some people, they think prophecy is just to take people's names or tell people's cell phone numbers. But you see, the real prophecy is to say what the Lord is saying and not what you're thinking. The real stuff that is happening according to the will of God. The phone numbers and the name is an attraction, you know. When Jesus says, I saw you under the tree sitting somewhere. But that's not the exciting thing. The exciting thing is that now you become a disciple. But you are not going to be a disciple if I didn't tell you about where were you this morning. So prophecy, people, they're excited about the revelation part of it, but not the delivery of the message. So when you pray longer, you become aware and you become how can I put it? You have revelation of what is happening. You know more than a person who prays little. And then you have a way to fight that other person can't fight. Yeah. You know, have you been in a situation where you feel like I'm hopeless? Let's say they're evicting you out of your house or flat. Mm-hmm. No money, you've skipped rent, they say they're evicting you. Mm-hmm. Okay? And then the police are here. But if you had an attorney, they'll come and say, according to South African law, you cannot be evicted until you have this and you have that. And really, you find that the police can't take you out. The owner of the place can't take you out because of the information your lawyer has. Mm. Now, which one would you choose to be? A hopeless tenant or be a lawyer? Because a lawyer, then you have got, because you know the rights. So a person who prays longer, they know the kingdom rights. Mm. Bible says, I'll give you the keys of the kingdom. So there are things that you can just close. Mm. So we as ministers, we can open. So if somebody says, I can't get married, I want to get married, then I just open. And you get married. Yeah. You say, I want a baby, I open. Mm. You say, I'm in a wheelchair, I want to get up, I open. Because you pray longer. Mm. The lesser you pray, you just say, oh, if God, by God's grace, you will walk. By God, no. The grace is that you should walk. Mm. It's just that you need somebody with the capacity to give you. The last one on that point, the Bible says, my people perish. Mm. This is not because they don't have wisdom. Mm. Not because they don't have tears. Not because they are not praying. No, because they have no knowledge. Mm. But supernatural knowledge comes from prayer and praying in the spirit. Because if you're praying in words, you pray the knowledge that you have already. Praying in tongues, you are downloading new knowledge that you didn't have. Then suddenly you are aware, you know. So I think praying longer is important. But pastors, we tend to say people must pray. Why can't you teach them how to pray? And let them decide to pray longer. Because, you know, I started teaching people about praying in the shower, pray while you're walking in the store, you know, pray while you're washing dishes or cooking. The testimonies we got, people say, you know, I actually prayed for the whole 7 days. And then those prayers were more than hours because I wash and I clean for 2 hours. You know, I cook for this long. I take a bath and shower for this long. And I realize that, wow, I've said so much. So don't tell people to pray this much. Just teach them how to pray. The need to pray longer will always be there, and they will know what to do when the time comes.
Wow. I'm going to let you conclude with this one, because you say pray for a marriage or pray for a baby. And something clicked in me that you spoke yesterday. I want you to talk about it as you're concluding, about being specific in prayer.
Okay.
Because someone will say, God, I'm praying for a man. And then you get a crippled man, and God heal all the crippled men.
Yeah.
Or you get a man that is foolish.
Yeah.
You
abusive.
Just pray. Abusive.
Yeah.
Now, what's the specificity of prayer?
Yeah.
Well, how important is that? Like, I think if we are to follow that, you'll find you'll pray longer because you don't just say, God, I need to be married.
You don't summarize.
You don't summarize. you need to tell God in detail.
Yeah.
What's the importance of being detailed in prayer?
That's powerful. Mm. That's powerful. I think we take the story of a widow woman who goes to Elisha. Mm. Now, this woman is saying, my husband passed away. Mm. Now, the people I'm owing, they're here to take my children and make them slaves. I assume she's hoping that the preacher will sign a check.
Yeah. Definitely. Yeah, you get that.
The preacher say, okay. By God's grace, the preacher asks, what do you have? Mm-hmm. And she says, I've got little oil. What has that to do with the money I'm looking for? Mm. The preacher says, well, take that oil. Number one, go borrow vessels. So which means two people who are unemployed. You have to be specific about the job you want. If you want a job where you're going to go to work at 7 in the morning, make it so you get in at 7, you knock off at 5. After prayer, 6 o'clock, get up, take a bath, and dress up and be a person who's ready to go to work. Mm. There's no work, but the faith says, I must act. Mm. Even if you have nowhere to go, but you have dressed up properly, you can clean the house, but faith says, I will wake up at 6 like everybody who goes to work. So it is very important to be specific. Do you want a job where you're going to travel? Okay? then do you have a passport? So after prayer, go to Home Affairs and make a passport. Why are you making a passport? No, because I'm getting a job that I will be traveling. You see, like I like what you said yesterday, go get a learner's. Because you see, the job that needs the license is waiting for the learner's. It will pass if you don't have a learner's. And it's not demons, not devil, it's not the witches, it's you. You didn't have a learner's. So when you are specific that I want a job, say I want a job with a car, then when the job is not coming, the question is, where is the license? Then that's why the job has not come yet. So it's very important to be specific. So a woman with oil, then she had to open a business, you know. And then we don't know how long it took. The Bible doesn't say, you know, the whole thing of selling. It's not like the first day people came and bought. She had to market. She had to find strike. She had to do a marketplace. She had to ask the sons to work. She had to have a cash app system, financial system, and all that. Then when the money came, she had to go and make arrangements to say, I'll pay monthly. Then she was having her bills. And the Bible says she had a living out of that oil. When you pray for money, God gives you a specific idea. When you pray, you need to be specific to say, what do I need? So I used to pray for, randomly say, I just pray for the car. And then the car would not come. And the Holy Spirit says, no, be specific.
What kind of car?
What kind of car? And why do you need that car? Then I started to say, then I left the big names, I won't mention names. I left them because I realized I didn't have a reason why I need that specific car. You know, then I realized that, okay, some of us are depressed. We want things, but we don't know what do you want it for. Why do you want a 5-bedroom house if you're struggling to clean a 2-bedroom house? So then I said to God, no, I don't want a 5-bedroom house. I just want maybe a 3-bedroom house, not 5. Because where I'm staying, it's a 3-bedroom house. I don't know the other rooms. I don't enter those other rooms. So last time I saw them is when we were moving in, because I'm in my office, I'm in my room, I'm in a sitting room, well, a kitchen. But why would I have all these rooms if I don't use them? Why do I want 3 cars if I can only drive 1? Why do I want so much food if I can only eat 3 meals a day? So be specific. If you want a husband, number one, you should know why do you want a husband? Because the husband will be your Lord. He will be above you. You have to submit to him. If he says, I don't like this friend, I don't like the skirt, I don't like this church, according to the word, you must obey. So if you're not ready to obey, then don't pray for the husband. You know. So be specific, be aware of what you're asking for, and then walk it by faith. Then you will get it. So most of my prayers, I've done it like that. So I get an idea, and then I go to prayer. And some things don't need prayer. They just need you to act.
Wow.
Yeah.
Lord, I need a husband who dresses good, who prays, who is afraid. So being specific.
It's good. It works. Because the man who, the woman who's not prayerful, already when you meet her, and then she speaks the language of the world, you don't even propose. Because in your prayer, the what you ordered, you know, in heaven, it's not what you see. Wow. So you won't even waste your time by proposing. I get shocked when people want to marry unbelievers. And as a Christian, I get shocked. I'm thinking, is this the prayer you made? God, you said, give me any man. Because you need to be specific. If he's not born again, it means he is serving the devil. There's two things here. You serve God or you serve the devil. If you marry unbeliever, you then have come into equal yoke with the devil. Because that person who's not born again, who lives inside of them? And if it's going to be your head, then the question is, who's going to be your head? You see, so be specific. I want a Christian man, number one. I want a man who gives. I want a man who loves family, who will take care of our children. You see, now your prayer is only 2 minutes. Because now we are, and you're just dealing with one area in your life. You have not even touched your clothes. You have not touched your health. You have not touched your ministry work. You have not touched your boss who's troubling you at work. You have not touched your colleagues. You have not touched the thieves in the community. Imagine if you are putting all this thing together. Whoa, your prayer will be like 5 hours. You'll have a problem. So that's why the Bible says we must pray without ceasing, which means consistently. There must be Monday prayer, Tuesday prayer, Wednesday prayer, personal prayers, because we can't gather all the time. then if we are gathering on Thursday or Friday, then we come. If you pray at church, you are likely to pray about souls, kingdom things. If you are praying in your room, you are likely to pray about your bed, new bed you want, pray about the fridge, you pray about the things that you... If you pray at work, you're likely to pray about sales, about your performance at work, about your colleagues. So your environment, wherever you are, when you pray, you will discern in that area.
I like what you said when you said you have to be, when you know what you prayed for, you don't just jump into anything that comes. It's interesting because Joseph had a vision from God that 12 brothers are going to bow, 11 brothers are going to bow down to you.
Yes.
And the time came for that dream to be fulfilled, and he saw 10, not 11.
Okay.
Because one was left with Jacob.
I get you.
And then he told them, go get your young brother.
Yeah.
Because what he was seeing was not what he saw.
I hear you.
When he prayed, when God gave him the dream, they were 11.
Yeah.
But now they are 10.
They are 10.
But he knew, okay, if I pray for this.
Sure. I've never looked at it like that.
If I pray for 11.
Yeah.
If there is 10, I don't tell myself, but at least it's closer to 11. No. I'll just take it.
It's not the will of God.
It's not the will of God. Yeah. God said 11.
Yes.
So 10 might be closer to 11, but 10 is not 11.
Yeah.
So if I know what I want.
You then go for it.
If I'm specific.
Yeah.
Then when the devil tries to present
something else, that looks,
I would say, no, that's not it.
Yeah.
Because there is power in being specific.
True. Mm. And I like that because some of us, we have friends that are not prayerful. Friends that are still in the world. And we keep them. But God tells you, this friend is not good. Mm. Why are you equally yoked with people who are not born again? In the name of I'm friendly. So you need to be specific. Tell God, I don't want friends who are not prayerful. I don't want... You see, one of the things I did in my house when I was praying for my children, my daughter now is in university, 18 years old. So all this time I was praying the prayer, say, Lord, may she never fall pregnant. May she never find a boyfriend that will cause her to drink. When they see her, they must be scared of her. I cover her by the blood of Jesus. I said, my words, whoever touches her will be in trouble. Then when she gets to 18 now, she's going to university. So I said to her, I'm changing prayers now. Now get married. I said, you better find a husband at university. Mm. I had to go to God and change my heart. That protective heart, I had to change it now. Because it will chase a potential husband. Mm. Why? Because at church we see these 50-year-old ladies who have not got married. And they are still looking. But you can find that it's their father who closed when they were 16.
Wow.
But for God to unlock. Mm. You see, the Bible says, whatever you open is open. Whatever you close is closed. Mm. So I had to tell her. So I went to God, but I went to her. Mm. I told her that at university, you are likely to meet your husband. Mm. So don't fall for just anyone. The guy you meet and who says he loves you. Look at everything, his teeth, his ears, the way he works, the head. Because that's how your children would look like. Yeah. And I said, don't mess my grandchildren up. Mm-hmm. Get a guy who is proper. Then I open the door. So if you tell me in a relationship, I'm not going to shout at her. I'll say, let's meet for coffee. Let's meet the guy. Mm-hmm. Because both me and her, we are hopeful to see a husband now. Mm-hmm. You see? So that's how the power of prayer is. You open things and you close things. You know, you chase bad friends, you attract good friends. So wherever she goes, she gets me. She is favored, she's a leader, and all is working. So I think we should do that. Very important to be specific. Say what you want. If I was telling God, so I was praying, I said, Lord, you see, like you've got beautiful hair, nice long hair. I said, Lord, I want to have afro. And for years I pray, and even at church they laugh at me when I say, when I say somebody beautiful, I said, please, after church, come lay hands on the pastor. Then the Holy Spirit showed me that, no, what happens, even though you want the hair, it's not going to be supernatural. You need to get some medication because it's not like you are bold. But because maybe of something, whatever happened, maybe you're using a cheap product. It's like a ladies who lose hairline. Mm. It's not the demons. No, we credit them too big. They are shocked. What are you talking about? It's the poor product you put. Then it eats the hair. So now when you are praying, we must tell God, I want the hair back. Mm. Then God is going to tell you, put the moisturizer, do this and do that. It's like somebody who wants a nice skin. The Holy Spirit will tell you, sleep early. Stop this thing of being on TV at 1 a.m. and you want a nice skin. So be specific. I think it's good. It has helped me. It's helping our family. If you want to lose weight, somebody said, oh, I'm gaining weight. I said, oh, what did the Lord say about your weight? He said, the Lord is quiet. I said, no, you're lying. You have not said anything to God about your weight. Then she asked me, okay, what do you do? What is your advice? I said, number one, fasting will help you. I said, not fast 21 days beginning of the year. Fast weekly. Fast on Tuesday, fast on Wednesday. Skip 2 days of eating, or even 1 day. She said, oh, I'll try it. She met me 2 months later, looking nice and trim. I said, what happened? She said, oh, I've been fasting 2 days. I've been praying, so I'm praying for, she's got a youth ministry burden. So she said, I use that as a burden, and I put fasting there, and I drink a lot of water now, no more sweet things. Guess what? I look good, I feel good, and spiritually I'm growing. I said, there you go. Be specific.
Wow. It's a good way to close it. Be specific. We are blaming demons where they are not.
Yeah.
You're gaining weight. Just stop eating too much.
Yeah.
Because some things we have to address them the way they are.
Amen.
It's been a privilege. It's been an honor. Thank you, everybody that has been joining,
Amen.
That is watching this video, men of God.
Thank you
for the revelation, and thank you for being a blessing to the kingdom
Amen.
Of God.
Amen. Amen.
It was a pleasure.
It was good talking to you. Thank you.
God bless you. Thank you very much.
Amen.
Amen. God bless everybody. Bishop signing out.